What's up you guys, Aditi. Welcome back to our channel. I want to show you a picture. What do you see? If you want, just pause the video right here. Take a good look at the picture. And then write down in the comment section, I would really like to know what you actually see. And today we are going to actually talk about all these weird things or games our visual system plays with us. So let's go. Today, we'll talk about gestalt psychology. Now, gestalt psychology is one of the school of psychology like psychoanalysis. Everybody knows psychoanalysis because of Sigmund Freud. And I've made a video on history of psychology or different schools of psychology. If you want to check it out, I'll leave the link in the description box below. This is how it looks like. Okay, so gestalt psychology's focus is on understanding things as a whole. So we have our mental processes, and mental processes include perception, sensation, experiences, thoughts. And gestalt psychology believes that these mental processes cannot be broken down and then understood and studied. They need to be studied as a whole. Hence the slogan, the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. To understand gestalt psychology, let's understand what perception actually is. Perception is the method by which people take all the sensations they experience at any given moment and interpret them in some meaningful fashion. So no two people are going to look at one thing and perceive exactly the same thing. Let's take this example. I am sure everybody has done this. Like you and your friend were cloud gazing and you saw this one cloud and it was shaped like a horse, but your friend thought that it is shaped like a cow. So what I'm trying to say is that two people looking at one thing are going to perceive with different interpretations. And this is what gestalt psychologists are studying. They're trying to understand these concepts, the rules of human perception. Gestalt principles are based on this idea that people have a natural tendency to force patterns in whatever they see. And I'm going to keep showing you pictures all throughout this video. So feel free to pause anytime you feel like, take a good look and then move forward. The image you're looking at right now, tell me, what do you see? One person will be able to see a young girl, whereas another person will be able to see an old lady, an old hag. Sometimes you will be able to see one for a little bit and then it kind of switches and then you see the other one for a little bit. I don't know how that happens, but take a good look. We'll go on to the next one, which is a little more dramatic. If you stare at the center point here and blink, I think that works, because I guess you can see it looks closer to you while the others kind of go at the back, and when you blink it kind of flips, so the one that was closer to you moves back. It's very difficult for me to explain, but I'm sure it would be doing its thing, like flipping in and out. This is called as a nectar cube, and you'll find many examples on this on the internet. Let's talk about gestalt clause. When we look at something, it has edges, it has distinctions, and our visual system has to figure out what goes with what. And our visual system understands this by this process called as grouping. Let's look at this image for a second. We tend to see that it has four vertical groupings, but in reality there are only 16 circles, and that's it. Our visual system groups these four circles together because they seem in close proximities to each other as compared to the ones that are to their left or their right. And this rule or law is called as proximity. Another example, we tend to group horizontal bars. So the white circles go together and the black or the gray circles go together, and that's because the white circles are more similar to each other and the black ones are similar to each other. So we tend to see them as grouping together, and this rule or gestalt law is called as similarity. Let's look at another one. If I say that there are four lines and you can group two lines together, many of you will say that you can group this and this together, or this and this together. But you can actually also group this and this, or like that. and that would make a perfectly reasonable interpretation of it. But we don't want to see it that way. We do not see it that way. Because our system likes things to continue. And this is something we call as good continuation. And hence, this rule or gestalt law is called as continuity. Let's look at this one. I am sure that you guys don't see three Pac-Men. But you see three complete black circles with one white triangle sitting on top. But actually, there is no triangle there. These lines make you feel that way, which is called as illusory contours. This is because our perceptual system likes simple interpretation, something similar to things we have already experienced before. And obviously, there are a lot of circles and triangles in the world, but there aren't a lot of Pac-Men anywhere in the world, unless you play Pac-Man a lot. And this rule or law is called as closure. If anything's bounded by something else, we tend to see that bounded thing as all being part of the same thing. And this is called as area. If you look at this one, we could view it as a triangle with a bite out of it. And this is also a triangle with a little bite out of it. And they're touching up against each other. But again, we don't see this like that. We like simple things like two overlapping squares. So our visual system prefers things to be relatively symmetrical. And this rule or law is called as symmetry. Let's look at an example which kind of combines all of these together. Pause if you like, take a good look. Try to not let your rules of human perception get in the way. Kind of think outside the box, leave it in the comment section, okay? But I'll just continue talking. This kind of looks like four complete black circles with a square and a white square sitting on the black square and the four circles. But actually, it's just a Pac-Man and a kind of like a triangle. It's like 90 degrees, right? It's a right angle, I guess. I think that's what I could call it. Let's talk about another gestalt principle. Let's take an example. When you look at my top, there are different colors. It's blue, there's red, each where there are these magazine or newspaper cutouts. But you don't see these things as different objects or as designating parts of an object. You take it as one whole object, the top. I mean, how do we do that? It's because in real world, things aren't static. They tend to move. And movement provides a very important cue. Let's take another example. Let's take an example of a frog. A frog is camouflaged in a leaf or with a leaf. You don't see it until it moves even a little bit. Just a little bit, and then you can spot it right away. The next thing I'll talk about is related to memory. I will make a video on memory, I promise. But let's see this first. If you look at the middle item or object, it is with these letters and boxes and numbers around it. But if you look around it, that's when this object looks like a B or like a 13, depending on what is around it. So even though it's the exact same sensory stimulus, due to the context, we understand and can interpret it better. So if you don't look at A and C and 12 and 14, look at the middle object and it is the exact same thing. So depending upon what is around it, we kind of interpret it due to the context. Let's look at some constants. There are three types of constants. So the first one is size consistency. I'm going to show you a picture of rocks. If you look at the size of the rocks, you'll see that the ones that are closer to us seem bigger, whereas the ones that are farther from us, they look smaller. Now, the smaller rocks, right, you don't actually think that they are small in size, right? You think that they look small because they are far from us. And this is what size constancy is. Like, you assume the size to stay constant. You assume that the rocks that are farther from you are the similar size as the rocks that are closer to you. They just look small because they're further away from us. Okay, and this rule or this whatever this is, it applies to these pictures as well that we kind of take with these monuments. The second one is shape constancy. So when you are looking at this clock that's right in front of you, you perceive it as a circle. Even if it is held at an angle and it actually looks like an oval right now, but you still continue to think of the clock as a circle. The same thing applies with this door. It's rectangle, but even when it's opening or it's ajar, you still think of it as a rectangle. And the third and last constancy is brightness constancy. Brightness constancy refers to our ability to recognize what color remains the same, regardless of how it looks under different levels of light. So, look at these two pictures. She is still wearing the blue jeans, whether it's light or dark, and Samurai guy is still wearing the green pants, whether it's light or dark, or even in this one. So, without color constancy, we would constantly be reinterpreting color and we would be amazed at the miraculous conversion our clothes undertake. Now, let's look at how our perceptual system deals with these complexities in the world. Look at this unclean, disrupted room and we only see objects. We do not really see shades of light or shadows, we just see objects, and we see all sorts of objects, okay, and we can identify them based on our past experience or memory, okay, and even using gestalt laws can like continuity. For example, you can look at this vase right here. We don't actually think that the vase jitna bhi dikh raha hai, that's all there is to that vase. No, we actually assume that the part of the vase is hidden behind the leg of the table. That is the gestalt law of continuity. Okay, and if I point out some objects to you, like, oh, what is this? Oh, what's this? Oh, what's this? Or even these huge chunk of soft toys in this big trunk, you would be able to name a bunch of them even though they are all smooshed together. The funny thing is that we don't even appreciate this ability that our brain just does this so effortlessly. And this is all because of our memory of our past experiences, something that we've already experienced before. So let's take this example of this ukulele, right? So somewhere in our mind, there exists this concept of ukulele. So we know that ukulele is a smaller size of a guitar and it has four strings, for example. That's the concept of ukulele we have in our head. So when we see a ukulele in real life or in a picture, we connect with that concept and we recognize what that is, and we do this very quickly. This process or this thing that we can do really quickly, it's called featural variation. Okay, so imagine the concept of chairs. I'm gonna give you these 9 chairs in front of you, and I want to ask you, like, what defines a chair? Like, what is a chair? So I would say that it has a seat that we can sit on, it has a backrest or a back, and it has 4 legs. Okay, that's the concept of a chair. So if you look at the second picture and the 5th picture, they look like prototypical chairs. But look at the 3rd one. I guess it has a seat and a back, but it definitely doesn't have legs. Or look at the 4th one. It doesn't have 4 legs. I don't even know what that is, like a weirdly squiggly S shaped chair. Or the 8th one, it doesn't have 4 legs, it has 1 leg, it's a pedestal. But although these chairs do not fit in the concept of chairs that we have, we still identify them as chairs. I'm marveled by this. Like, how do we do that? But before we end here, I want to give you one last picture. Okay, look at this one. These are all spots. And leave it in the comment section. What do you actually see in this picture? I would really love to know. And that is it for today's video. I hope it was good, because I actually do not have this topic, sensation and perception. Mumbai University has omitted it, but I just studied it so I can make this video for you, because if there is somebody out there who has this topic, then this video is great for you to revise or maybe understand some concepts that were difficult for you. I'll also leave a few other links that can help you out with concepts or revision in the description box below, so check those out as well. Other than that, please give this video a big thumbs up, comment down below what other videos you want me to do, and subscribe to this channel, join the community, hit the bell notification so you'll be notified every time I post a new video. I'll see you next Friday with another psychology video. Move, they move all together. And this tells our visual system. The next thing I'll talk about is related.